I've been doing a lot of thinking lately about Miller Lite. What a profound concept. It's got a third less calories than I probably thought it didn't even have.
Not bad.
Do you ever hit home run?
Sometimes.
Well, if you get hurt and miss work, it won't hurt to miss work. And they give you cash, which is just as good as money.
Who else on earth can upstage the Affleck duck?
Oh, boy.
Jockey brand white underwear.
Jockey brand color underwear.
Why?
Color.
Why?
Color.
Why?
Color.
Where did I go wrong?
Ready?
Yeah.
Oh.
Everyone has a New York dream. Come find yours.
Who in the heck is this guy, Philharmonic?
Hi, this is Yogi Berra. When you come to the fork in the road, take it. Oh, I shouldn't say that.
They think I make these things up, well, you know what I'm saying? I don't. It just comes out.
And it's less filling than it would have been if it was more filling than they didn't want it to be.
All right, that's good. Okay.
From the deep south, this is Colonel Yogi Ashley Berra.
Right, please make your appointment.
Sure enough.
Yeah. Hey, you're getting better.
Yeah, you're ready for the White
Hussein. There's not an ounce of guile in him. He is the most honest, decent, loved man. He's the most quoted living American. He is the personification of truth, of being yourself.
There's no side to him. I mean, he is what he is. Yogi is a decent, respectable human being, and he's not trying to put anything over on anybody. He is what he is. I think people literally love Yogi. I don't think there's any getting away from it.
He's got his yogi-isms. I mean, he's always coming in the locker room now, and he come over to my locker and he's telling me stories and things like that. But I think everyone just loves Yogi Berra.
Jeter's a good kid. You know, one time he struck out bases loaded, you know, high. He swung at a pitch and struck out a high pitch. I go in the next day, and Jambi's sitting there having a sandwich. And I said, Jeter, you look terrible on that last pitch. What the hell are you swinging at a 3-2 pitch up there for? He said, well, you swung at him. I said, I hit it, you don't. And Jambi laughed like hell. That's one thing I like about the Yankees. I love going out there, talk to them. I love to go to spring training and see the guy. And they enjoy seeing us. That's what I like about it. They really do.
Knowing Yogi the last few years, he is definitely one of the classiest, fun guys I've ever met. This guy, you can talk to him. He wants to teach you about hitting. He wants to talk to you about the game that you just played. He wants you to win championships. It's just great having him around day in and day out.
There have been great Yankees, and Joe D is at the top of that list. And Yogi's right there with him, and so is Mickey. But there's probably never been a Yankee that I can think of that probably was said more times to him, well, you can't do that. You can't do that. Who then turned around and did it.
Was he a warrior?
Oh, he was a warrior. Oh, was he a warrior. In every sense of the word, and I love that word, as you know. But here was a real warrior, yeah. If I was in a trench, I'd sure want Yogi Berra with me.
I think Yogi has been so accessible and so genuine. He's unlike any other major star or celebrity that people are accustomed to. He's never lost any of his humility or niceness. He's just a regular guy. He's still Yogi Berra.
Yogi Berra is a national icon, an American folk hero. Over the years, we have laughed at his yogiisms. Everything from nobody goes there anymore, it's too crowded, to the now legendary, it ain't over till it's over. But Yogi Berra, the man, is so much more than just funny sayings. The son of Italian immigrants, he grew up during the Great Depression. From his family, he learned the value of hard work, perseverance, honesty, integrity, and loyalty. As a teenager, he participated in the greatest military operation in mankind's history, the invasion of Normandy in June of 1944. After the war, he anchored the great Yankee dynasty from 1947 through 1963. Other stars such as Joe DiMaggio, Mickey Mantle, and Whitey Ford may have shone brighter, but none were more important to the Yankee success than was Yogi Berra. He is more famous and more beloved than he could have ever possibly imagined as a youngster playing ball on the sandlots in his hometown of St. Louis. Yet through it all, perhaps the most amazing thing about Lawrence Peter Berra is that all the fame, fortune, and adulation has not changed him. He is the same person he's always been, a modest and shy man of great character and dignity. At a time in our history when the world of sports has produced so few good role models for kids to look up to, Yogi Berra represents everything we want our children to be. And for all his accomplishments and a remarkable life, Yogi himself wants his lasting and living legacy to be the Yogi Berra Museum and Learning Center in Montclair, New Jersey. A place children can come to learn not just about baseball, but about history, culture, society, and science. Indeed, a man's true greatness should not be measured by what he accomplished for himself in his lifetime, but how he touched the lives of other people. Yogi Berra has touched millions of people. He is more than a Hall of Fame ball player. He is a Hall of Fame man.
I'm glad my dad didn't miss the boat. That thing there is great. And, you know, he came over first. You know, I had two brothers born in Italy. And he came over first and then sent for my mother and two brothers. And it's great. I love it all.
Between 1890 and 1920, over 2 million Italians immigrated to America. They were seeking a better life for themselves, but more importantly, for their children. Among these immigrants was Pietro Berra, who, according to immigration records, came through Ellis Island in 1909. He came from a small village outside of Milan named Mauvais. He eventually settled in St. Louis, in an area known as the Hill. This was a neighborhood made up primarily of immigrant Italian families. After settling down and getting a job in a brickyard as a laborer, Pietro brought his wife, Paulina, and his two sons, Anthony and Michael, over from Italy. A third son, John, was born in 1922. And on May 12, 1925, their fourth son, Lorenzo Pietro Berra, was born. From the time he was a youngster, Larry Berra's all-consuming passion was sports.
We played a lot of soccer, a lot of baseball, softball, cork ball. We called it cork ball with a little ball with a broomstick. We played bottle caps. We played a lot of bottle caps. Play on two at each side, pitcher and the catcher. And I think that would help me a lot, you know, playing that bottle cap. Because that's pretty tough to hit. You know, you can make that thing go up. You can make it go down. And also softball helped me. We used to play softball in the morning and had a baseball game in the afternoon. Softball, you couldn't swing at a ball hard at a softball. You had to just meet the ball.
All the Berra boys were excellent athletes, but their father, Pietro, didn't understand his son's love of sport, especially their passion for the All-American game of baseball. Pietro believed in hard work and providing for his family.
My dad wasn't old-fashioned. He came over to this country in 1909, got a job in St. Louis, and they had tough times when he came in. Now I think they know everybody's got a car. We never had a car. Never had a telephone. As far as that goes. You know, if your dad told you, like my dad used to tell me, if I won't go out at night, he used to tell me what time you're going to come home. I say 10 o'clock. You better be home at 10 o'clock. Because we didn't have a telephone to say if we're staying out later. But if you tell him the time, when are you going to be home? You better be home at that time. And like, they had respect for him, never left the table until he was finished eating. Never, boy, don't dare get up the table.
The three oldest sons worked to help support the family.
My dad, I used to kid him. I said, Pop, you realize if you let your sons play ball, you've been a millionaire. They said, well, blame your mother. But that was fun. I had all the three brothers had a chance to go and play. But my dad didn't believe it. He didn't know what baseball was. He knew soccer, but he didn't know baseball. That's funny, you know, like Joe Gargiulo. You know, we grew up as kids together. My brother and his brother worked together in a restaurant. My dad and his dad worked in a brickyard together. And it was one happy family on the hill in St. Louis.
He's really a product of where he grew up. And the place on the hill was a place where people did not have much, and they were blessed to have what they had. And I think Yogi, that place really defined who Yogi Berra is, and there was never an air of pretense about him, never has been. And he is what he is. He's just as he says, I'm still a kid from the hill.
Pietro's younger son, Larry, was known to everyone on the hill as Lottie. His mother, Paulina, couldn't pronounce Larry with her heavy Italian accent. So, whenever she called her youngest son, it came out Lottie.
That's what they used to call me, all the kids in the neighborhood, Lottie. They used to call me, and that's the truth.
Later on, Lottie became Yogi. It seems when Lottie was playing American Legion ball, there were no dugouts on the field. So, he used to sit with his arms and legs folded and watch the game. A friend of his saw a newsreel that featured people from the Far East meditating in the yoga position, which reminded the friend of the way Lottie sat on the ball field. He told young Lottie that he sat like a yogi, and the name stuck. With his older brothers working, young Yogi had the opportunity to stay in school. But his passion for playing sports, especially baseball, made him restless in the classroom. And he quit school at age 14.
I just went as high as grade school and I went to work. I had all kinds of jobs, you know, just to get out and play ball. I worked in a shoe fair, I worked in a coal yard, worked on a Coca-Cola truck. I worked at a famous bar with the big department store on the truck, you know, delivering packages. I did almost everything. I really did. But I quit, though, you know, because when baseball season, I quit, you know, then go back to work again.
Growing up, Yogi's favorite team was the St. Louis Cardinals, and his favorite player was their star outfielder, Joe Ducky Medwick.
I liked him because he used to be my paper customer. You know, them days, papers were only 3 cents then. And he used to buy the morning paper from, you know, coming home from the games, and he gave me a nickel. And he said, keep the 2 cents. I said, boy, he's great. That's a big tip.
Yogi's older brothers convinced their father to let Yogi pursue his dream of playing baseball. They all worked to help feed the family, so why not let Yogi play?
The brothers that told my dad, let him go and play. We'll see what he could do. And so he decided, okay, we'll give him a chance.
I say in my book, The Duke of Flatbush, I mention Branch Rickey a lot because Branch Rickey taught me. I mean, he was such an exceptional man. He was way ahead of his time. I mean, he developed the Cardinals, developed the Dodgers, and went to Pittsburgh and helped develop that organization. But he could look at a young player, 17 years old, and see them 5 years from then. He could just picture how big they were going to be. Say, you're going to be 6'2", you're going to weigh 195 pounds. I mean, he could just picture you, just how you're going to be 5 years later.
In 1941, 16-year-old Yogi and his best friend, Joe Garagiola, went for a tryout with the Cardinals. Branch Rickey was the Cardinals' general manager.
That's the year he knew he was going to go to the Dodgers, but he wasn't allowed to say that. You know, that's like tampering or something. And he told me I'd never be a big league ball player. You just, you know, and he offered like $300, and Gerge only got $500. I said, I want $500, and I'm not going to play.
Branch Rickey was a shrewd man. His time in St. Louis was up, so during that tryout, he purposely did not sign Yogi and told him he wouldn't become a major leaguer.
When I signed the contract with the Yankees, I get a telegram from him to report to Bear Mountain, Brooklyn Dodgers spring training. But it was too late, I signed.
So Branch Rickey sort of outsmarted himself a little bit in that way.
The Yankees never scouted me at all. The only one that scouted me was we had a Cardinal scout. Jack McGuire was a Cardinal scout, and Lou Maguavo was a Brown scout. And they saw him. They begged Rickey to sign me. You know? They said, no, we're not signing you. And then I asked Lou, can I go with the Browns for the $500? And he said, well, if they don't want to give you $500, we're not going to give it to you either. John Schulte used to be the coach over here with the Yankees. And he lived in St. Louis, and he came over and signed me.
That spring, Yogi was assigned to the Yanks minor league team in Norfolk, Virginia, the Norfolk Tars. Yogi's baseball career, however, was interrupted by World War II. He was drafted into the service and chose to serve in the Navy.
I took the Navy. I figured, well, it's cleaner maybe, you know.
This would lead to his being a participant in the invasion of Normandy on June 6, 1944.
Well, we asked for volunteers. We got tired of staying, you know, with nothing to do. You know, I was at Little Creek, Virginia. That's at Norfolk where I played. I knew a lot of people there, actually, when I went from boot camp to there. And we were in a movie all of a sudden. And the captain come out and said, we're looking for volunteers for this one on the boat. Shape going in, and then we get a command from the lead boat, spread out. We maybe go about 40, 50 yards apart, and we covered the island. We went in before the Army went in, and we stayed off about 300 or 400 yards off the beach, and we fired the rockets in. If one guy, the lead boat, fired the rocket, if it hit on the beach, everybody lets loose, and then we just hang around there in case they ran into any assistance. You know, we knew where to throw some more rockets. It's funny. I don't know why it wasn't funny, because I was looking out. My officer told me, you better get your head down here if you want to get blown off. But I just wanted to look at everything.
On his return to the States, Seaman First Class Lawrence Barra was assigned to the Naval Base in New London, Connecticut. He played ball in New London against some stiff competition.
They sent me to New London Submarine Base. And I said, I told the officer, I didn't volunteer for no submarine. You know, you have to volunteer to go to submarines. And I said, I didn't volunteer to go in a submarine. He said, no, we're sending you over to ship's company. You know, that's what they call when you get the station on another station. And I went over there, and Jimmy Gleason played for Cincinnati Red, was the lieutenant commander. He was in charge of the ball team. At first, he didn't think I was a ball player. I was in it, he interviewed me, he said, what do? I said, I play ball. You do? He said, who'd you play for? I said, Norfolk. You know, and he said, he thought I was a boxer, actually, when I came in. Because we had, you know, we were just starting there. But find out he didn't play me at the beginning, even. I pinched it and hit a home run. He said, then I got to play all the time. That was just like playing AAA, because we played the St. Louis Browns, we played the Washington Center, we played the Giants and everything. And that helped me a lot. And boy, we got to play, and it was great. You know, Walter Matheson was our, he pitched for the old Washington Senators. He was on our team at New London Submarine. We used to go in on Liberty, and we went to Yankee Stadium. That's where I met Big Pete and Little Pete, you know, the clubhouse guy. And they talked to me, and I said, geez, I belong to the Yankees. They looked at me, and, you know, I said, you kidding? I said, no, I'm going to be up here one of these days, I told them. And so they looked at me like I was crazy.
When Yogi was discharged from the Navy, the Yankees sent him to their AAA club in Newark, New Jersey, the Newark Bears.
I was home in St. Louis, and I was supposed to receive. I got out in May, close to my birthday, and they asked me to go to Kansas City. I was just ready to go out the door. I get a telephone call. We changed our mind. Report to Newark in Rochester. So I had to go to Rochester. I wanted to go to Kansas City. That was closer to home. But I went to Newark, and Selkirk was their man. He's another one. They said, they sent me this guy. He didn't think I was any good either. So I had to do the same thing, pinch hit, got a hit, played 77 games there, and I had a good year. I only played a half a year.
He was called up to the big league club at the end of the 1946 season. In his first big league at bat, Yogi gave a sign of things to come.
Barra swings, and that one's going to leave the ballpark. Well, what do you know? Larry Barra, they call him Yogi, his very first time at the plate in the major leagues against the A's. And what does he do? He hits a home run.
In 1947, Yogi Berra became the regular catcher for the powerful New York Yankees. The Yankees won the pennant in 1947 and faced the Brooklyn Dodgers in the World Series. In the fourth contest of that series, with young Yogi behind the plate, Yankee hurler Floyd Bevins almost made history when he carried a no-hitter into the ninth inning.
It was the fourth game of the 1947 World Series. Last of the ninth, and Yankee Bill Bevins was close to pitching the first no-hitter in World Series history. Dodger Cookie Lavagetta was sent up to pinch hit with two on and two out against a 2-1 Yankee lead. Bevins was one out away from baseball immortality. But that was as close as Bevins ever came. Lavagetta banged the next pitch against the right field fence for a double. Two Dodgers scored, and Brooklyn had tied the series in one of the most exciting finishes ever seen in Ebbets Field.
Yogi always blamed himself for Bevins losing the no-hitter. In that last inning, Dodger runner Al Gianfrido stole second base on Yogi with two outs. Had Yogi thrown him out, the game would have been over, and Lavagetta would never have had the opportunity to win it with his double.
I was a lousy catcher.
Nonetheless, the Yankees won the series in seven games, and Yogi Berra had a world championship ring as a rookie. Yogi had a poor World Series, although he did hit the first pinch-hit home run in series history. Still, he had a lot to learn. In 1947, during the offseason in St. Louis, Yogi went into Biggie's restaurant. While there, he saw a beautiful young waitress named Carmen Short. He wanted to ask her out, but was shy, and had the bartender do it for him.
He come over and said, no, she thinks you're married. She don't go out with married men. She thought I was Terry Moore, the center fielder of the Carmen. And I said, no, I'm single.
Yogi and Carmen were married in January of 1949. They would have three sons, Larry, Tim, and Dale. Many years later, when Yogi was managing the Yankees, he would have the pleasure of managing his own son, Dale. Despite all Yogi's accomplishments in an incredible life, his number one priority has always been family.
It's been 53 years in January we've been married. She's a good gal. She gets on me, but she's a good gal. She gets on me, but she's a good gal.
1949 was truly an eventful year for Yogi Berra. He married Carmen in January, his first son Lawrence Jr. was born in December, and Casey Stengel was named manager of the Yankees. Stengel seemed an odd choice to manage the powerful Yankees. Up to that point in his career, Casey had managed only second division clubs in Boston and Brooklyn. It was Casey's idea to bring in retired Hall of Fame catcher Bill Dickey to teach Yogi how to be a good defensive catcher. Although Yogi hit well in 1947 and 48, his defensive work behind the plate left a lot to be desired.
Bill Dickey had a great deal to do with molding Yogi into an all-around catcher, and certainly motivating the pitchers, working the pitchers, was a huge part of Yogi's success behind the plate.
They brought Dickey in, his coach, and I owe a lot to Dickey. I really do. He worked me, but I enjoyed doing what he taught me, how to throw the ball and everything. I learned a lot from him. I really did. I just happened to work it. I used to go up in the room, go in front of a mirror, practice going in for a ball. But it paid off.
Between 1949 and 1953, the Yankees were a juggernaut, winning five world championships in a row. Yogi won his first Most Valuable Player award in 1951. During the first part of this incredible run from 1949 through 1951, the great Joe DiMaggio was the team's marquee star. In 1951, a promising rookie named Mickey Mantle joined the team, and he would carry the dynasty. Yet, through it all, the anchor of the team was its catcher.
DiMaggio was really the signature player on the Yankees in the 40s, and certainly Mickey was in the 50s, but Yogi was that bridge. He was a constant. He was the one that Casey Stengel knew that they could not win without. There's no question he was the anchor of the dynasty. I think Yogi's baseball greatness is a little lost sometimes because a lot of people certainly know him as sort of this funny homespun philosopher and sort of his comical image. But anybody who's ever played against him, and if you talk to any of his peers, and certainly Ted Williams said he was the greatest catcher in the game. If you talk to any of those folks who played with or against him, you know how much they respected Yogi Berra's baseball ability.
The Champs are ahead in the fourth game, with Yogi Berra facing Constanti. Yes, Constanti again, and the Yanks' great catcher belts one into the right field seats. The second home run of the 1950 series. Both Yankee and Yogi's put the American Leaguers out front. Rookie Whitey Ford has one out to go when Semenik lofts one deep to left, but the ball gets away from Woodling, and two Whiz Kids whiz cross the plate. From 5-0, it's 5-2. The Bills have the tying run at the plate. That's all for young Mr. Ford. Casey Stengel is forced to play his ace, Allie Reynolds, to face pinch hitter Lopata. And that's all for the Whiz Kids. Reynolds gets his man out swinging, and it's all over. The Yanks have won in a sweep, the sixth time they've done it, and their 13th World Series victory.
Yes, sir. Best outfield, best all-around player I ever saw. He did everything right. That's funny. I never seen him slide for a ball like this, like we did. I slides for a ball, but he caught everything chest high. He just had a knack. Never. And you see him go to second base, you say, oh, what is he going for? He got there. You think he's going to get thrown up, but he got there. He did just right. Because he always told me, when I played right field or left field, he used to tell me, if I hear your voice, you got the ball. If I don't hear you, I got it. he warned you, you don't know that. But he was a good guy. You know, a lot of people say, well, he was this and that. That wasn't the way he was, that's all. He just wanted to be on his own. He just didn't want people to bother. He had to know you. My wife loved him. Because we used to go play in the American Airlines golf tournament. And he always asked my wife and I to go eat with him, you know. So, you know, you could talk to him. He wanted some guy to talk to that he felt safe with. And he was great. We played cards on the train. He didn't do anything. He'd tell you, you want to go out with me to eat? And you try to pick up the check. He said, if you pick up the check, you'll never go out with me again. And the guy said, he's tight. To me, it was nice.
I was watching your show like yesterday, I think it came on, maybe the day before, and you had Yogi on. And he was talking about one of the all-time greats, Joe DiMaggio. And you asked him who was the best player, and he said Joe DiMaggio. And it kind of hurt me. I mean, Yogi, I mean, first of all, we had two catchers in the bullpen that was better than Yogi. He drew people in because of the things he said, you know?
And his name, it was a very unusual
name. Ralph Houken, Charlie Silvera, I figured if we did, they could have played on our team, I mean, just as easy as Yogi.
So you're saying that Ralph Houken and Charlie Silvera were far superior players than Yogi?
Not far superior, but they were
They were better good. Players.
Yeah, maybe a little better.
Good. I'm looking forward to having
Yogi
back.
Hey, I'm just kidding. As far as I'm concerned, Yogi's right. Joe DiMaggio, he was probably the best all-around baseball player that there ever was.
I saw him in Arizona. When we went to spring training, when we changed the Giants, what was that, 50 we went, I think, right? My God, you could see, he could run, boy. He could run. He had two good legs. No telling how good Mickey could have been if he had two good legs, you know? It's like you said, if I knew, they give him money for 40-40, whatever it is, I would have tried that a long time ago. Casey wouldn't let him steal. He wouldn't do it, not unless it was important. He didn't want him to hurt that knee of his.
Me and Yogi got in an argument one time about how tough it was to call pitches. And I said, Whitey was pitching the next day. I said, let me call the game tomorrow.
I said, you call the game and I'll watch you. What do you want to do to use for a fastball?
Like I would bend over for a curveball and stand straight up for a fastball, right?
If I wiggle my glove, it's a changeup.
And Whitey's pitching a great game. In fact, I think he's got a no-hitter.
And we go to the seventh inning. He comes in, Whitey was pitching. He come in. I said, well, you're going pretty good, Mick. He says, I quit. Then he said, I got you this far, and now you go to the other one.
That's when I realized the pressure that's on a catcher calling signals.
He was one heck of a guy. He's another guy. You know, a lot of people say, oh, he's going drunk and that. We had fun. The heck, we went out and I used to kid him, though. I used to say, 11:30, I'm going home. You guys are staying? You can stay. I got to catch tomorrow. You're out in the outfield, I think.
The decade between 1947 and 1957 was a golden age in the history of New York baseball. Every World Series in that 10-year span featured at least one New York team, with seven of them being Subway Series between two New York teams. The Giants played the Yankees in the 1951 series, but the most historic and exciting rivalry was between the Brooklyn Dodgers and the Yankees, who played each other six times in that 10-year span. The Bombers won the first four series they played against the Dodgers in 1947, 49, 52, and 53. Still, it was a classic, hard-fought rivalry.
We never were intimidated by the Yankees. We never thought we were a second-rate club or going to be the Cinderella team and all that. Recognizing the Yankees were great, they were not lucky. They had a deep team. They had great pitching. The difference between those two clubs was slight. And, you know, I mean, these teams are equal on a daily basis. But to give an answer on why we had trouble in the series, there is no answer.
Then in the series, when that would come about, if it came about, and they did many times during my era with the Dodgers against the Yankees, I was never successful against them because I was too busy throwing home runs to Yogi Berra and guys like that.
Well, I think we had a complex, if you know what I mean, the complex of not beating them. Maybe sometimes you say, well, it's going too good right now, something's going to happen. But you can't really think that way. You have to be positive more than anything else that can beat them. They're a great, great series. And that's why we crowded ballparks at that time, because of just that type of relationship that we had.
If we had that Corfarito, Duke Snider, Andy Pafko, that Coxie, we had Pee-wee, Gilliam, Hodges, Campanella. It just happened. We beat them.
Casey Stengel and George Weiss take a close look at the Yankees in training, and old Case is looking ahead to a sixth straight world championship. Could be. But before then, there are a few questions to ask, like, who's on first? Joe Collins, Bill Scorin, Frank Ligia, or Eddie Robinson, late of Philadelphia, wearing that old number 36 now that Johnny Mize has retired. Johnny Sane is also retired, but the champs are still knee-deep in talent and the team to beat. Hank Bauer is back, and Yogi Berra, and Gene Woodling. A powerful lineup with Gil McDougald adding more power. Bill Dickey gives a few pointers to rookie Elston Howard, the first Negro player on the team.
In 1954, Yogi Berra won his second Most Valuable Player award. Although the Yankees won 103 games that year, the Cleveland Indians won 110 games to take the American League title. In 1955, the Yankees won the pennant again, with Yogi winning his third MVP award, his second in a row. Once again, they faced their arch rivals, the Brooklyn Dodgers, in the 1955 World Series.
Boom! Farrello and Snider race back, but it's up in the seats for another home run, the fifth of the game and number two for Joe Collins. Yogi escorts Joe home for another glad hand reception at home plate and in the Yankee dugout. 6-3 is the score, but it is not the final score. With one run in the eighth and Jackie Robinson on third, pinch hitter Kellert faces Whitey Ford. The windup, and here comes Robinson trying to steal home. He's safe, says the ump. He's out, says Yogi Berra, and brother, is Yogi hopping.
He was out. That's all I can say, out. I still say, nobody ever bring that. I said right away, out. Then he hit my glove over the plate, sliding it, but I got him.
The series went the full seven games, and in the sixth inning of that last game, Yogi Berra was once again involved in a play that would become a part of baseball legend and lore.
Yogi lifts one to left field. Two men on. If it drops, it's trouble. Sandy Amoros makes a one-hand catch, whips it to Reese, who fires to first to double up McDougal. The Yanks is dead. Johnny Podras pitched his heart out, and it's all over but the shouting and the tumult. The Dodgers win it 2-0 and win their first World Series.
And they just changed outfielders. You know, it was out there, Gilman, and he went to second base. He relieved Zimmer. Zimmer was playing second base, and it just happened again. If I remember correctly, I tried to bunt it the first pitch. I fouled it off, and then Casey changed. That's the only time I was tried to bunt, I think. And then I hit the next pitch to left field. If Gilman was out there, he would have never caught it. Sandy, much faster, and left-handed. It was the right play.
The Dodgers' 1955 World Series victory was the only time they would beat the Yankees while the team was still in Brooklyn. In 1956, the two rivals met again in the series for the sixth time in 9 years. The series was tied at two games apiece when Yankee hurler Don Larsen took the mound for the Bombers in Game 5 at Yankee Stadium.
Two out in the ninth, still not a hit. Dale Mitchell is pinch hitting for Magley. He stands between Larsen and a perfect game. The tension in the stands is terrific. Here it comes. He strikes him out. The Yanks win a key game 2-0, and Don Larsen is baseball's man of the hour. he pitched the first no-hitter in a World Series and the second perfect game in the history of the major leagues.
Don Larson, heck yeah. That day, anything I put down, he never shook me off once. He got everything over, what I called for. And he went to three balls only on one hitter, and I was in the first inning on Pee Wee Reese. But Mickey made one heck of a catch up left center. I still know he only threw about 97 pitches that day. That's pretty good. We didn't say anything to Larson. We didn't come, everybody didn't pay attention to him. You know, probably if it was 9-0 or something, you know, it'd be all right.
Don Larson's perfect game often overshadows the fact that Yogi Berra once again had a remarkably productive World Series in 1956.
Yogi Berra's real name, Lawrence Peter Berra. Three times most valuable player, he belted two home runs in the final game of the Yankees' World Series triumph over the Brooklyn Dodgers in 1956. He set a career record for most homers hit by a catcher. The kudos came from everywhere, including Dodger superstar Jackie Robinson.
I don't know what I'm laughing about, to tell you the truth, but the Yogi here, the way I feel about it, had it not been for him, Nuke probably would have been in there a little longer, because he certainly was throwing as well as I've ever seen him throw. And this guy here, to me, is just as fine a clutch hitter as I've ever seen in the game today of baseball. He does a tremendous job.
What's your reaction to this, Yogi?
Well, I was very thrilled, but, you know, with these Brooklyn Dodgers, that five run wasn't even safe. I was glad when Skarin hit that home run with the bases loaded.
In that same 56 series, the glory of Don Larson pitching the first perfect game in World Series history was shared by catcher Yogi Berra. Was he ever happy in that final strikeout?
You know, it was Don Larson's moment, and yet Yogi was there to share in it and participate in it. And I think the team highlights are the things that really were so meaningful to him, because he's more proud of the team accomplishments than any other individual accomplishments.
The Yankees won the pennant in 1957, but lost to the Milwaukee Braves in the World Series. In 1958, they met the Braves in the World Series once again.
The World Series saw Milwaukee pitted against the Yankees, same as last year, in a diamond spectacular. Bill Skowron's final game homer clinched a 6-2 victory in the seventh game for the Yankees. In the crucial game of the series, the Yankees had demolished a 2-all tie with a 4-run onslaught. The New Yorkers became the first team in 33 years to win the series after trailing 3-1.
In the late 1950s, Yogi saw more playing time in the outfield. This saved wear and tear on his body and gave young catcher Elston Howard more playing time behind the plate. In 1960, the Yankees won the pennant and faced the Pittsburgh Pirates in the World Series. The Yankees were heavily favored, but the Pirates took it to 7 games. Then, Pirates second baseman Bill Mazeroski stepped to the plate in the bottom of the ninth of the seventh game with the score tied at 9.
Bottom of the ninth, 9-all, and Bill Mazeroski comes to bat. And he plunks a tremendous throw high over the wall, winning the ball game, and the Pittsburgh Pirates win their first World Series in 35 years the hard way. Mazeroski dances through a line of backslappers the last 90 feet as Pittsburgh begins its celebration of victory in one of the most titanic struggles in baseball history.
Pittsburgh beat us. I cried all the way home on the airplane. There's no way I could have went over to Mazeroski and say, nice hit. You know, when I see him now, I'm like, God.
There are those baseball historians and fans who consider the 1961 Yankees perhaps the best team in the club's history. They were certainly a powerhouse, led by the slugging of Mantle, Maris, and Berra. From the start of that 61 season, both Mantle and Maris made an all-out assault on Babe Ruth's single-season home run record of 60. The two sluggers were neck and neck for most of the year until Mantle got injured late in the season. Maris continued to hit home runs, and on the last day of the 61 season, made history.
Crowd in Yankee Stadium for the final game of the year is here to cheer not the Yankees, but Roger Maris, who comes through with his 61st homer for a new baseball record. It's a qualified record, however. Babe Ruth set his 1927 record of 60 homers in a shorter season of 154 games. And it took Roger four more games to hit 60 and 162 games to hit 61. The baseball commissioner has ruled that Ruth's record stands until someone hits 61 in the same number of games. That ruling does nothing to dull the roar of the crowd today. They won't let Roger alone until he comes out of the dugout and takes a bow. The newest Sultan of SWAT, Roger has set a record that will probably stand for many years.
One of the biggest thrills I've ever had in my life was when Roger Maris hit his 61st home run. I get goosebumps. I was in the hospital, you know. I had to go to the hospital before that season was over, and I watched it. Roger ran around the bases with his head down the whole way around. He never tipped his hat or jumped up and down going, yeah, yeah, you know, and all that. When he ran into the dugout after hitting that 61st home run, which I think is the greatest feat in professional sports I've ever seen, they had to push him back up out of the dugout to take a bow.
Roger was a good ball player. Now, he could do everything, run, throw, and hit. And that's no lie. He could do all of that.
Yogi Berra was a clutch hitter, always at his most dangerous when the game was on the line. He also had a well-deserved reputation as a bad ball hitter. If he could see it, he could hit it.
Yeah, I could see like a ball up here now. I might not saw it that good. Next pitch, you throw it there again, I see it good. Swing it. You see it, hit it. And I always say, man on third, man, fly ball. It's a run batted in and no time it back. You know, these guys wait, the ball's got to be down the middle. It don't have to be down the middle. You'll hit it. If you see it, hit it.
Throughout his career, Yogi Berra always took great pride in the way he called a game. He studied hitters closely.
Well, you study, you know, you watch. I used to watch the guys, how they stride and everything up when they were hitting. And I'd find out, you know, if he steps into a ball, you know, if he keeps running, I said, well, I got to go inside now with him. You know, I go inside with him. Now, if he steps back a little bit, I'll go away with him then. You know, I just watched the hitter and everything, and I find out what guys could hit a curveball pretty good, who couldn't. I would save that pitch, you know, for certain times. And a lot of hitters, you know, when Whitey come up with a slider, they told him when he got it down pretty good, what the pitch is? Well, that's his curveball, I used to tell him. And Whitey could get a curveball over any time he wanted to. He had good control. Lopez, same way. It isn't the hard you throw it, it's where you throw it. That means a lot. And I used to get mad at pitchers. Rashid, I used to get mad all the time. I used to go out to him and say, pitching in the big leagues for 10 years, you can't get the darn ball over until you get back to your little dago.
The Yankees won the World Series in 1961, beating the Cincinnati Reds. They won the pennant again in 1962. This time beating the Giants in a seven-game World Series. The Yankees, however, were an aging team. Yogi himself was 38 and nearing the end of the line. The Yankees won the pennant once again in 1963, but faced a Los Angeles Dodger team with a pitching tandem of Sandy Koufax and Don Drysdale. They lost to the Dodgers in four straight. It was the first time the mighty Yankees were ever swept in World Series competition. During the 1963 season, Yogi Berra was a Yankee player coach. What Yogi knew during that season and what manager Ralph Houk and Yankee ownership knew, but nobody else did, was that Yogi would become the Yankee skipper in 1964.
He come over and asked me, how you like to manage? I said, manage who? He says, the Yankees, because he says, I'm going to go upstairs and we're going to, you know, I want you to watch, you know, during the season. Nobody knew about it. Just him and I. I said, okay, I'll look.
What Yogi didn't know was that management felt the Yankees would have a down year in 64. Yogi would be fired, and Cardinal manager Johnny Keene would be brought in to manage the Bombers for the 1965 season. The plan backfired. Yogi went out and won the pennant. The Yankees got off to a slow start in 1964, and it seemed they were out of the race, but then an incident with a young infielder named Phil Lenz seemed to spark the Yankees.
Well, very simply, we had just lost four straight games in Chicago, and we were in a team bus, and everybody was very quiet and sober. And I had just bought a harmonica the day before, and I was just learning how to play Mary Had a Little Lamb. And I started playing some notes, and somebody down in front called out, shove that harmonica.
I said, put it away. I didn't say it that way, you know, like, but I said, put it away.
And I go, was that Yogi? I said, what'd he say? And I turned to Mickey Mantle. And
he asked Mickey, what'd he say? He said, play it louder.
So I continued to play, and
Then he played again, and I went back there, and I slapped it out of his hand, you know.
We had a big verbal argument back and forth, and I was, what are you getting on me? I'm giving 100%. You know, we were all upset, man.
Thankful said he got up and got mad, you know.
So the next day, I apologized to Yogi. It was in headlines all over the country. It was like war headlines. It knocked Vietnam off the front page. It was like this, the incredible, like World War III.
Yeah, we won after that. I know that. We went up to Boston, I think. We went up to Boston. We started the streak. And we came along real good.
And then a few days later, a Horner Harmonica Company called me. And they offered me $10,000 to endorse their harmonica. And that was as much as my salary was that whole year. It was incredible. So I was on the back of the Yankee yearbook with my Yankee uniform on in 65 with my harmonica in my uniform saying, play it again, Phil.
The Yankees won the pennant and faced the St. Louis Cardinals in the World Series, managed by none other than Johnny Keene. Even without an injured Whitey Ford, Yogi took the Yankees to a seventh game before losing. The day after the series, Yogi went to the Yankee offices expecting a contract extension.
I guess I was fired before even the series was started, I guess. I don't know. I really don't know what happened there, but they did call me in the following day when we came back. They said, we want to make a change. And I said, well, that's what managers are. They're hired to be fired. And, no, they wanted to give me a job in the front office. I said, no, I don't think I want it. I said, I want to stay in the baseball, you know, instead of going to the office.
And I think he was surprised and stunned that he was fired. But he was very gracious about it, and he did, you know, in his, parting remarks, he said, I owe the Yankees everything. They were the ones that did give me the chance to play baseball, so I hold no grudge.
After his firing by the Yankees, Yogi was hired as a coach by the New York Mets. The Mets had come into existence in 1962 when the National League added two teams. They were managed by Yogi's old skipper, Casey Stengel. The Mets were, in their first few seasons, perhaps the worst team in modern baseball history. Yogi spent the 65 season under Stengel and coached under Wes Westrum in 1966 and 67. After the 67 season, Westrum was fired. Gil Hodges was hired, and the Mets became serious.
They hired Gil Hodges. And Gil was good with the pitchers. You always have a meeting the opening day with the pitchers, and not opening day, before opening day. You call them all in. And all the coaches are in there. He said, when I come out to that mound, I want that ball in my palm. And that did it. Bill Hodges did a heck of a job. He was a good manager. I liked him.
In 1968, the Mets finished in ninth place, but they were improving greatly under Gil Hodges. And most believed that they would become contenders in 2 or 3 years. No one, however, could have possibly imagined what they would do in 1969. In one of the most exciting and memorable seasons in baseball history, the New York Mets overcame 100-1 odds to win the World Championship. It was a season that lifted the spirits of an entire nation, and it came at a time when America sorely needed its spirits lifted.
It's more than a dream come true. It's something that every boy from 7 years of age, you know, up to manhood, you know, in his wildest dream, he couldn't come up with a scenario to fit this.
I enjoyed it. It was great, though, you know, we won like that, because we come from last place up there. But we weren't that far out, you know, from first. Everybody had a funny year that year. Everybody was beating each other.
In the spring of 1972, tragedy struck when the beloved Gil Hodges died suddenly of a heart attack. Yogi Berra was named to replace Hodges as the Mets manager. It was a sad time for Yogi, who greatly respected and admired Gil Hodges. The Mets finished in third place that year under Yogi. It was also in 1972 that Yogi was elected to the Baseball Hall of Fame. For most of the 1973 season, the Mets played 500 ball. Yogi rallied his team, and the Mets went on to win the Eastern Division title. They beat the powerful Cincinnati Reds for the National League pennant and then lost a hard-fought seven-game World Series to the Oakland A's.
That's when I said it ain't over till it's over. Yeah, I enjoy it. I think I have a pretty good record. I won, you know, two pennants, right? In the 5.5 years I managed. That's the only thing I regret. I had everything happen to me in baseball. You know, I had good things. They asked me, what was your best moment? I guess that my bad moment, I said, I guess not winning the World Series. But I was in it, so it was good.
Yogi was fired as the Mets manager in 1975 and returned to the Yankees as a coach. Throughout American history, there have been figures who have been so beloved and legendary that they are known to all by just one name: Washington, Jefferson, Lincoln, Yogi. From very early in his career, Yogi's innate honesty, sincerity, and his enormous popularity with fans throughout the nation made him much in demand for television commercials as well as for guest appearances on TV shows and in movies.
I've been doing a lot of thinking lately about Miller Lite. What a profound concept. It's got a third less calories than I probably thought it didn't even have.
Everyone has a New York dream. Come find yours.
Who in the heck is this guy, Philharmonic?
I fly.
Well, if you get hurt and miss work, it won't hurt to miss work. And they give you cash, which is just as good as money.
Well, bless my soul, here's Colonel Whitey, Stonewall Ford.
I do.
Sure enough.
And last but not least from the Deep South, this year's Colonel Yogi Ashley Burra.
What? Please make your appointment.
Sure enough.
Do you play for a New York team?
Yes.
Are you either Mickey Mantle or Roger Maris?
No.
Have you played several positions this year, notably catcher and left field? Are you Yogi Berra?
In 1984, Yankee owner George Steinbrenner named Yogi as manager of the Yankees. They finished third in 84, and when the 85 season started, Yogi was promised by Steinbrenner that he would be the manager for the entire season. After a 6-10 start by the club, Steinbrenner fired Yogi. Yogi always understood that managers were hired to be fired, but it was the way Steinbrenner fired Yogi that upset him. Yogi vowed never to return to Yankee Stadium as long as George Steinbrenner was the owner.
When I got fired, the owner called me all the time. I'm fired. That's the way I feel about it. You know, George never called me when I got fired. He had Clyde King come down telling me I'm fired. Never heard from him at all. And I said, I'll never go back to the stadium again. And, because, you know, managers expect to get fired. What the, that's the game, you know. As long as you hear from the right guys, instead of somebody come in and tell me I'm gone.
As a man of his word and a man of principle, Yogi kept his vow and did not return to Yankee Stadium for 14 years. Finally, sportscaster Susan Waldman prevailed upon Yankee owner George Steinbrenner to apologize to Yogi. In January of 1999, Steinbrenner visited Yogi and his family at the Yogi Berra Museum to make amends.
We had a very special guest here. I was supposed to come out the last time when Mike Francesa was here, but we couldn't make it, so I brought somebody with me. Mr. Steinbrenner, you remember Mr. Berra. Mr.
Yes,
Berra, you remember Mr. Steinbrenner.
They talked to my kids and all that. My kids kind of helped out a little bit. They said, Dad, it's about time, you know. Well, I've enjoyed it so far. I really has. He's been good to me, and so far he's been good. He's saying the right things. It's all right.
In 1986, Yogi became a coach for the Houston Astros and stayed with the team until 1989 when he retired. It was in December of 1998 that the Yogi Berra Museum and Learning Center on the campus of Montclair State University was opened. The museum is more than just a tribute to Yogi's remarkable life and career. It is a learning center where the history of baseball is used to teach children about many subjects, including history, science, society, math, and much, much more.
I think the museum is a major part of Yogi's legacy because of his lifelong commitment to kids, to supporting educational and charitable causes.
This is a great place, and what Yogi's done here and what he's doing here is outstanding. To be a learning place where people can just come and just be somewhere to go after school and things to do instead of being out on the streets. It's sort of like the Boys and Girls Club, but a higher end version with a lot more amenities around here.
Like a good friend of mine just passed away in California, a banker, George Grazadilla. He's the one who said, Yogi, you're a lucky man. You're alive to see this. Usually when you get it, you're dead.
In the summer of 1999, Yogi was given a day at Yankee Stadium to mark his return to the Yankee family. On that day, the Yankees brought in Don Larsen to throw the ceremonial first pitch to Yogi Berra. That day, with Yogi and Larsen looking on, David Cone pitched a perfect game. The next year, Yogi, along with Johnny Bench, was selected as one of the catchers on baseball's all-century team. It was a well-deserved honor. Among his World Series records are 14 World Series appearances, 10 World Championships, 71 hits, and 10 doubles. He had 358 lifetime home runs and won 3 Most Valuable Player awards. He is, quite simply, one of the greatest players ever to play the game. There are few Americans more beloved than Yogi Berra. His whole life, both on the field and off, he was underestimated. But Yogi succeeded beyond all expectations. Yet the most remarkable thing about Yogi Berra is that all the success and acclaim has not changed him. He still sees himself as that Italian kid from the hill who got a few breaks, got lucky, and made good. But there is much more to Yogi Berra's success than just luck and a few breaks. There is honesty, integrity, character, and modesty. The strong family values he learned from his parents. The principles of hard work and perseverance. The belief that he could realize his hopes and dreams when just about everybody said it was impossible. He is an example of the American dream come true. He believed in himself when nobody else did. He became a Hall of Fame ball player, an American icon, and most importantly, he has remained what he's always been, a true Hall of Fame man.
It's over.